Reverend Michael Reckord, who will just visit us with such inspiration that we will go home celebrating that we have come this morning. And I welcome you, Reverend Michael Reckord.
Thank you so much, Reverend Sonia. Thank you so much for that welcome. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
We are having an intimate gathering this morning in candlelight, no less. I was going to say romantic because of the candle, but let's just leave it at intimate. There is candlelight and there's daylight, but no GPS light. For a change. I welcome all those who are here in the temple this morning, in the sanctuary, and I also welcome those who are listening online. We've been going for some 2 years now online, and it has been going very, very well. As usual, it is a lovely morning here at the Temple of Light in Kingston, Jamaica. Why is that, I wonder? It usually is a lovely morning. Right now, it's sunny. But even when the sky is overcast, the day is beautiful. And it's partly because the center's grounds are so good looking. Thanks, Sean and Marshall, who are doing it there within the sound of my voice, but they are the men responsible for keeping the ground so beautiful. They are assisted, of course, by the aforementioned sunshine and the occasional bit of rain. If there's anybody who is listening online who has never visited the church, please try to do so. You will love the loveliness. Friends, you could call my talk this morning a review of Diane Harmony's book. Here it is. 5 Gifts for an Abundant Life. The book is as beautiful as her name, Diane Harmony. But I'm sure it's because it is full of wisdom that it is also a text, not just a handsome book, but also a text for an accredited Centers for Spiritual Living course. I hope that you've been persuaded to do that course by the time this talk ends in 15 or 20 minutes. In essence, what I'm trying to do this morning is to give you a summary of that 8-week course in that 15 to 20 minutes. There is a pun on the word gifts in the clever title, 5 Gifts for an Abundant Life. Oh, Diane does offer gifts with the thoughts in the book, but in addition to that, the initial letters of the main topics in the book form an acronym that actually spells out the word GIFTS. Those topics are G, gratitude, I, intentions, F, forgiveness, T, tithing, and S, surrender. G-I-F-T-S. 5 Gifts for an Abundant Life. Each of the sections of the book on those gifts is subdivided into 5 short segments. The segments are an in-depth description of the chapter's gifts, then a mystic's thoughts on the gift, then a personal success story related to the gift, then instructions from Dan, which are designed to be heart-opening. And then, finally, there is a segment, usually very short, which is called Acknowledge Yourself. And in that final segment, you are encouraged to give a gift to yourself. And I'll be dealing with the broad sections, mainly through summarizing the shorter segment. Now, who is Diane Harmony? She tells us that she was a professional student in the school of pain. She does things like that. Poetically speaks about an abstract idea. She's been a student in the school of pain, she said, for some 40 years. And in that time, she believed herself to be a helpless victim of her circumstances. And those circumstances manifested mainly as a lack of money. Having too little salary, as she put it, and too many bills, she had various scapegoats for her circumstances. The scapegoats being the economy, her marital state as a single mother of three children, her sex, her education, her boss, and so on. And even God was actually a scapegoat, because she thought that God had forsaken her. Now, her financial situation got so bad that she couldn't withdraw money from the ATM. She had less than $20 in her account. So she formally declared bankruptcy. And when her dear daughter was getting married, she was quite unable to pay her way to the event or to contribute one cent for the couple's wedding gift. So in the early hours of that wedding day of her daughter, feeling sorry for herself, she started crying. I think it's really boring, for it went on for some 3 hours. But 3 hours into that feeling sorry for herself, sobbing session, 3 hours into it, she heard a soft voice within telling her to be still. She spoke back to the voice, and during the ensuing conversation, the voice spoke about gratitude and the miracles, it said, that would follow if she adopted an attitude of gratitude instead of complaining and despairing all the time. That very day, after the conversation with the boy, she transferred, she said, from the school of pain to the school of vision. And in the school of vision, over time, she said she met many extraordinary people, extraordinary teachers, and she gave up fear and the belief that there was not enough. And consequently, who won't be surprised, consequently, she started receiving. More immediately though, on her daughter's wedding day, which she had thought would have been distressing for her, it actually turned out to be wonderful. At the wedding and the reception, because of her changed attitude, money and other forms of help poured in. Diane reminds us that numerous benefits flow from an attitude of gratitude. Generally speaking, it causes the good in your life to multiply. She says, for example, and she gives this very interesting example, a story that we know, that it's because Jesus gives thanks for the 5 loaves and 2 fishes that he had, that he was able to feed 5,000 people. You know the Bible story. And gratitude, Diane says, changes someone from being judgmental into someone who is acquainted with divine perfection on one hand, and perfection also in life generally. And that includes the possibly distressing events of one's past life. The attitude of gratitude causes one to look back at those distressing events of past life in a new way. With gratitude. The gratitude segments in the book, 2 personal success stories are told by 2 ladies, Tina Fox and Canon Bell. Here's Tina. Tina was having a very difficult relationship with her boyfriend, Michael. And they were actually on the point of breaking up when one night, while they were driving in the car, she suddenly was able to see him in a different light. And I mean both literally, that is to say by means of the street lights shining through the rain on the windshield, and also figuratively. After weeks of looking at him with bitterness and anger, why? Because the way he was dealing with the world was different from her way of dealing with the world. She suddenly, in that moment of enlightenment, was able to see that his being different was okay. After a moment of shared laughter, as they talked about her new perception, the two were able to start speaking civilly to each other. And this marked the start down the long road to reconciliation. So that was Tina Fox's story. Canon's story was work-related. Believing that she was continually overlooked for promotion, she started feeling resentment toward her boss. This naturally made her, to her boss, a less pleasant person to work with than she might have been otherwise. Though, she stresses, she was always a very good team leader, the resentment was toward her boss. Then, at a church service one morning, the pastor asked the congregation about their feelings of unforgiveness. Diane immediately started to pray, and she suddenly, in that moment of prayer, realized that she should have been focusing on being thankful for the job that she had, instead of resenting people who moved up past her. And this sudden revelation led her to apologizing to her boss for her attitude. And it led to, eventually, to her getting the promotion and the raise that she wanted. All from an attitude of gratitude. Now, a key paragraph in the next section, next chapter, setting intention, reminds us of a fundamental metaphysical law, the law of manifestation, which is also known as the law of cause and effect. That law is activated when we set our intention to do something. Choosing one thing out of an infinite possibilities which are open to us. And I quote from the paragraph, this law of manifestation or what cause and effect. This law states that as a man thinketh, so shall it be. What we choose to think creates our experience. Through our thinking cause, we create our reality, the effect. From the realm of the invisible, we bring our conscious and unconscious thoughts, our intentions, into form. We make them visible. But that phrase, our thoughts, needs some unpacking. Diane makes a suggestion that I don't think I have encountered elsewhere. Our thoughts, she posits, do not originate with us, but with God. She invites us to see ourselves as swimming in the mind of God. She loves images. Loves imagery. So we see ourselves as swimming in the mind of God, with God's thoughts and ideas floating around in the sea of thoughts around us. So we latch onto them, the God's thoughts. We take them as ours, and then express them on behalf of God. As religious science teaches, most of us here would know, God needs us to express itself. So we express God's thought through ourselves, physical form, situations, etc. Then the other section in the chapter is by a mystic. And the mystic that Diane selects for the intentions chapter is our own Ernest Holmes, the founder of religious science. In the excerpt from Dr. Holmes's magnum opus, The Science of Mind, we get the reminder that as we are always thinking, we are continuously creating something. That means we should be continually asking ourselves if what we are creating through our thoughts are the things that we want in our life. And Dr. Holmes warns us that our creations should never hurt anyone, neither ourselves nor others. Let me add the common sense statement, which you have all heard before. If you don't like the things that your thoughts are creating, simply change your thinking. Now, everybody here I know, and I suspect that many people online have heard the phrase, change your thinking, change your life. Everybody knows it, yes? Of course we do. I thought so. But did you know that I start facilitating an online course with that name on Tuesday? I hope you come along. A companion chapter to the one on setting intentions is one on manifesting intentions. In that chapter, Diane gives three main instructions. First, after you set your intention, you should adopt an attitude of detachment. This is where faith that the universe, God, automatically goes around about fulfilling the intention that you set. And I quote a key sentence on the process. Rather than using your willpower in a struggle to bring something about, You rest in the trust of God that what is for your highest and best good will be realized in the perfect time and space in your life. Unquote. An example that Diane gives is one that we've heard many times before. After you sow a seed, you don't worry about whether it will produce a plant. And you don't certainly go around digging up the seed every day to check on it. You trust, you have faith that nature will do its natural work. So that was instruction number one. The second instruction that gives us, let go of fear after you have set your intention. Some people, of course, will ask, how do I let go of fear? And Diane says, focus on the intention. And you know, focusing on one thing will push out the other from your mind. So if you feel fear, focus on the intention, and the fear will be pushed out. Her third instruction is this, pray. Diane reminds us of some of the things that happen when we pray. One, prayer aligns us with our higher self, our deepest inner purpose. When we pray, she says, we commune with God in an attitude of knowing and asking, not begging, bargaining, or beseeching. Then we strengthen our awareness of who we are. Who are we? God being. And how deserving we are. And in prayer, we see how sure we are that what we are claiming is for our highest good. Prayer reminds us too how grateful we are that the intention is already ours. You know that technique. When you pray, Jesus gave us this instruction, that you already have it. Assume that you already have it, and all you're doing in prayer is giving thanks. And then when you know you already have it, you only need to be willing to let go and let God bring about our heart's desire. And there you have it. Quite a lot happening when you pray. Next chapter. This is the next segment of that chapter. This is the heart opening instruction section. In that section, Diane gives us a template for a prayer. First, she says, we should get a prayer partner. And then you start your prayer as follows, and I quote, I know that God is everywhere present as love and the source of all good. Within the omnipresence of God, I know I am, in caps, I am a radiant expression of the divine source. As I know also this for my prosperity prayer partner, I am, we are, one in that which is holy and pure abundance. I know and claim that I am. Take your pick, living or experiencing or expressing or embodying your intention. You choose the word. And then after the prayer, your prayer partner will repeat the claim for you. And you close with the release paragraph from the prayer, which is this. I am thankful to know the truth. And I'm grateful to know think I am a loving, glorious being of God. I surrender this prayer into the heart of God and allow it to be. Amen. Good. So that was a prayer. Dan calls the next gift forgiveness, the largest of the family. And I can understand why. Forgiveness is a really, really big thing in the lives of many of us. And I found the chapter most interesting. And this is because the author has a novel interpretation of the word forgiveness. She breaks forgiving into the two constituent words, forgiving. And she explains that forgiving is a spiritual practice about, I quote, the giving of compassion, understanding, and unconditional love to self and others, unquote. It is not, as many mistakenly think, about giving in forgiveness. It's not giving in to someone's inappropriate action. It's not condoning their behavior. It's not even giving permission for the behavior to be done again. That is not forgiveness. It is not about either getting over some perceived wrong. Forgiving, she stresses, is neither about dishonoring ourselves it's not about dishonoring ourselves by refusing to acknowledge the real emotions that we had when we were hurt. Acknowledge them. Acknowledge the rage, acknowledge the hurt, acknowledge the shame. You may have felt those emotions when the other person treated you a particular way. It's not a sign of weakness. On the contrary, it is a sign of strength, spiritual strength coming from the heart, from our higher God self, not, she says, from the intellect. It comes from the heart. And it is important to remember that forgiveness comes from us, not from God. I really liked her interpretation. Forgiveness comes from us, not from God. Why? Because God is pure love. And God never has any need to forgive anyone of anything. Now, some people might be thinking at this stage that that is not what the Bible teaches. Because in the Bible, we need that God forgives sins. But what I just said, God is pure love and has no need to forgive us. That is what we truly students are told. We regard sinning as making a mistake, and of course, we can correct our mistakes ourselves. Here are some key sentences that I really like in that section, and they detail the perils of keeping anger and resentment bottled up inside. Like being unforgiving. I quote, forgiveness frees the forgiver. The result of unforgiveness is the very thing that you don't want. The binding of yourself to the person or situation you are judging or condemning. In the name of righteousness and expectations left unfulfilled, You have to move down life's path, amassing resentments and anger and guilt and regrets and shame that you drag behind you like a sack of stones on foot. That's vivid imagery. Imagine dragging the resentment and anger and guilt behind you like a sack of stones. You can just picture what she's talking about. And there's imaginative writing like that on every page, which is one reason that I call the book beautiful. That chapter ends with two psychologically fascinating models, letters. The first is by your inner child. And almost invariably, it is your inner child that was the part of you that was wrong, quote unquote. And it is written to the person who did the perceived wrong. That's the first letter. And the second letter is the response of the inner child to the letter. So the inner child writes the letter and responds. The first letter shares first your inner child's feelings of anger and sadness and fear and regret. Remember, Dan says, acknowledge those feelings. Don't dishonor yourself by saying, no, I shouldn't have been feeling all that. Acknowledge that. And then the letter ends with forgiveness and love. In the second letter, your inner child replies to the first letter, showing understanding for the hurtful action on one hand, and also gratitude for the letter. The letter exercise is really quite clever, and I recommend it to anyone with unforgiveness issues. Now, forgiveness is such a big ticket that Diane devotes two chapters to it. The first, the one I was referring to just now, is the one on forgiving others. The other chapter is on forgiving yourself. And it is quite insightful. In it, Diane makes the critical point that without self-forgiveness, you won't have a life of abundance. And remember, the whole book is about how we can have an abundant life. Diane says that her many years of counseling showed her that self-forgiveness is difficult. Why? Because we are tending to listen too much to our critical inner voices. Who are those voices? They are the opinions and judgments of parents, teachers, and other authority figures we looked up to, perhaps even fear as children. She calls those voices the committee. And she notes that they hold us firmly in guilt, doubt, or fear about decisions and actions that we took in our past. She says, I quote, "The committee's job is to convince us that we are our mistakes. But we must stop listening to the committee. Of course, that could be difficult. But fortunately, she gives us four steps to help us to stop listening to the committee. Step one, stop denying that we made mistakes. Yes, we made mistakes, but we are not the mistake. Secondly, separate your true self, your God self, from the mistake. Then third, admit the mistake to another person, preferably your prayer partner. Where confession eases the mind. Fourthly, we are, if possible, to make amends to the person that we harmed or hurt. And at the end of the chapter, she gives us another step to take towards healing, and this is a long, serene, guided meditation. Diane acknowledges in the next chapter on tithing, and tithing is giving 10% of all earned income to the place where you get your spiritual nourishment, your church, for example. She acknowledges that the topic is a difficult one for many people. And this is because, she points out, that those people don't realize that tithing is a spiritual practice, and they mistakenly tend to give their tithes from a sense of lack, believing that tithing diminishes them. But actually, it's the opposite. Through tithing, what we do is we align ourselves with the universal abundance of God, and generally, we receive more than we give. Tithe freely and gratefully and lovingly from a place of abundance, that Dan writes. That was a quote. Contrary to popular belief, there is no mystery about why tithing works. Tithing works because of the law of attraction. When you give from a feeling of abundance, you will attract more abundance from the universe. We all know that. Law of attraction. The mystic for the chapter is New Thought icon Joel Goldsmith, who has a most interesting take on tithing. At the human level, he says, supply is about income, but on the level of spiritual food, supply is about outward. It's not income, it's outward on the spiritual level. Here is his reasoning. Since God is within you, and God is the source of infinite abundance, God fills you up, and you can't take in any more. Therefore, supply is what you give to the world from your abundance. Therefore, says Goldsmith, you must not try to get, you must not try to have, you must not try to draw to yourself. You must learn how to let the infinite flow out from you. Now that, I find, is quite an interesting concept on tithing. You don't demonstrate your abundance by your possessions, your pretty clothes, your pretty house, your pretty car. That's not how we demonstrate your possessions. You demonstrate abundance by how much you give to others. And Diane's interpretation of the final gift, surrender, is also interesting. She states rightly that to many of us the word has negative connotations. Surrender. Connotations like resignation or giving up or lethargy or I don't care anymore. That's how some of us feel about surrender. But she says the phrase let go and let God doesn't mean giving up control of your life to some power out there. Outside of me, it means letting the God inside take charge, surrendering to the you that is your God self. What you are surrendering is your little self, the ego self. One of the things I like about the book is its poetry. And not surprisingly, Diane draws to a close with a sentence on surrender that is as full of imagery being mental pictures, as the one I quoted earlier. She has a sailing on the sea image, and I'm quoting, surrender, she says, surrendering to the power and presence of God within allows us to float freely on the wisdom of the Holy Self, guided by the eternal voice of intuition and powered by the winds of the love of God, to the shores of infinite possibility. Lovely image. And she ends with this affirmation, which I'm asking you to repeat after I've said it once. I surrender to the power and presence of God within. Together?
I surrender to the power and presence of God within me.
And that was my penultimate word. And just before my final word, if you don't take the course, at least read the book. It will teach you quite a lot. Oh, by the way, this copy is from our book. I don't know how many more copies there are, but it's really, it's a beautiful book. And now, my final word. Namaste.
Gratitude, intention, forgiveness.